Yes, well, in the people.
So I went ahead and sent it in just to be able to have a meeting with the actual developer, like the people who do the system for
back there? Okay, okay, good. Welcome to the Education, Health, and Human Development Showcase. Oh yeah, that was a tiny bit of enthusiasm. I wanna hear a lot more in a bit, in a sec. Hold on, yeah, I had to get my sidekick up here. I'm Allison Harmon. I'm the Dean of the College of Education, Health, and Human Development.
And I'm Mary Miles. I'm a professor and associate dean of the Office of Scholarship Development and Academic Impact.
This is our first public event since February 2020, which was our last EHHD talk. So now you can see we've evolved in that sleepy time period. We have evolved this event into a showcase. And so first thing I want to do is say thank you to the faculty and staff and students who participated in our showcase. So I'm going to read them off, and then I hope that you will help me express our appreciation for that. So we had the Life Scholars Program. Do we have the counseling program? Maybe. But we have some counselors here. So counselors who are here. We had mental health support certificate, the food product development lab, hospitality management, art education, Paul Waldem and his students. Yep, right there. Music education. Thank you so much, Chris Olson, for setting the Caribbean tone for tonight. We had the Science Math Resource Center. If you didn't get a light up name tag like I did, you might want to go back and do that. And then we had our Center for Research on Rural Education. Thank you all. That was beautiful. Before we continue, I also want to thank the master planner for this event, Becky Stanton. Would you wave to the camera? I want to also thank our other Dean's Office staff who helped put this event together. So wave at the folks when I say your name. Sky, Marissa, Kristen, Kate, Beverly. I want to thank Kate Kaminsky for helping our speakers. Bill Fries behind the camera. And I also want to acknowledge the other members of our leadership team. Other than Mary, we also have Tricia Seifert, Department Head for Education. Rebecca Coltz, Department Head for Health and Human Development. there anyone I didn't thank who would like to be thanked? I'm just so excited to be here and to see all your faces and to have this event where we could come together and talk to one another and eat some excellent food and enjoy the creativity that is the College of Education, Health, and Human Development and hear from some great speakers. So I'm gonna now, since we're tag teaming, it's Mary's turn.
Each year, outstanding faculty are nominated for awards. Tonight, we are fortunate to have five of our award-winning faculty here to share a piece of their work with us. We will introduce them all so that we can move seamlessly from one speaker to the next. So here are the introductions.
So our first speaker will be Becky Hammack, assistant professor in education, will be talking to us about connecting to place, connecting to self, helping children discover their inner scientist engineer.
Next, we'll hear from Robert Carson. Dr. Carson, a professor in the Department of Education, will be celebrating his retirement at the end of this semester. But before he does, he's going to tell us about how art teaches us to see tonight.
Next, we'll hear from Wan Yuen Kuo, an assistant professor in Department of Health and Human Development, who will talk to us about redefining value-added food with sustainability in mind.
After Dr. Kuo, we'll hear from Anna Elliott, an associate professor in the PrAC counseling program. It says Department of Counseling, but that's not correct. From counseling, who will enlighten us with a presentation titled Meaning Over Measure.
Did you like how I stuck that in there? We didn't rehearse this ahead of time. Finally, we'll hear from Joe Hicks, who is currently serving as assistant dean for the college, in addition to being an assistant teaching professor in the Department of Education, and he will tell us about the vocation of VIM, becoming a Bobcat educator.
And then following our speakers, we will have a question and answer panel. And if you'll notice, there's pens and paper for you to put questions for our panelists on your table. So if you have a question, please write that down for us, and Alice and I will facilitate the panel after this amazing lineup of speakers.
So we will get out of the way now, and Becky will take over. She is the brains of this part of the program. This was up here. So we will take our notes and leave.
Good evening. I'm Becky Hammack, an assistant professor in the Department of Education. I grew up on a dairy farm in rural Appalachia. As a child and teen, I was always working in the barn or exploring the creek or the pastures. At home, I was learning all sorts of science, everything from animal science, animal growth and development to nutrition, horticulture through learning how to cultivate and grow different crops, physics through constructing and building, constructing and maintaining various farm structures and tinkering on equipment, chemistry through food preparation and preservation, even medicine through treating various ailments like mastitis. Throughout my daily experiences and explorations, I was learning so much science, but I didn't realize it at the time, because science in school was almost exclusively limited to textbooks and learning the facts, which was vastly different than the experiences that I had with science on the farm. It wasn't until high school in chemistry that science really started to become hands-on. But I didn't really mind all of those textbooks because I liked learning the facts. When I went to college, I majored in animal science, and I started to recognize that what I was learning in class was actually connected to what I was seeing when I grew up on the farm. For example, in animal nutrition, we learned about the different livestock requirements and we formulated diets for them. This took me back to when I was in the feed barn with my uncle, mixing together bags of supplement with the grain, and I remember him telling me exactly how much of each ingredient needed to be included in order to meet the proper needs of the cows. In animal breeding class, we learned about expected progeny differences, or EPDs. EPDs are an estimate of how an offspring would compare to the breed average. So for example, if a bull has a weaning weight EPD of plus 20 pounds, you would expect that the calves sired by that bull would, on average, weigh 20 pounds more than the breed average at weaning. I remember watching my dad flip through catalogs with pages and pages of EPD statistics for different bulls, and then choosing which bulls to order semen from for breeding our own cows. Understanding how to use EPDs was vital to making the right choices to ensure that the calves born would add value to our herd. During graduate school, I started working with kids, the humankind, and I fell in love with it. I discovered that I could marry my passions for science and working with children by becoming a teacher. Fast forward to my first year teaching high school biology. My principal came to observe me teach a lesson to my students. When he was visiting with me about the lesson the next day, he commented on a response I had given to a student who said, "Why do we even need to learn this?" My response had been, "Because this is your body. You need to know how it works in order to make choices about your health." My principal was impressed with the way that I had responded to the student because he thought I made a connection to the personal importance of the topic. I wasn't so sure. I left that meeting thinking about that student's question and reflecting over my own experiences. I had never asked, "Why do I need to learn about this in any of my science classes?" But I had asked that question about topics in some of those other courses. Why was that? After some thinking, I realized it came down to my personal interest in science. All things science fascinated me as a child, so I never questioned why I should learn about them in school. Then it hit me. For as much as I'm captivated by all things science, there are students who are just as unenchanted by science. For me, while the textbook and worksheet approach to learning science wasn't my favorite, I was still somewhat engaged just because of my love for the topic. But I also wonder, what would my experiences have been like if my teachers had connected my day-to-day experiences on the farm with what I was learning in the classroom? Maybe a different approach is needed. Maybe if teachers could tap into the local knowledge that children bring into the classroom and help them see how that knowledge connects to what is in the curriculum, then students would be more engaged in what they're learning. Fast forward 15 years, and this is at the center of my research. My goal is to help teachers develop science and engineering learning experiences that connect local knowledge and context to what happens inside the classroom. I was fortunate enough to join Judy Boyle and the Divide School Scientists on several occasions over the past 3 years. During those visits, I was able to witness how Judy created an environment in which science came alive and students became scientists who explored local phenomena. When students put on those lab coats, there was a visible transformation that took place. They were no longer children in the classroom. They were scientists, and they embodied that role. Whether they were exploring the school grounds to identify local species or identify macroinvertebrates at the Big Hole River to determine the health, the students were completely engrossed in what they were doing. by investigating the health of the Big Hole River and then presenting their findings to the Big Hole Watershed Commission, who, by the way, named them Big Hole River Ambassadors. The students were connecting classroom science to the local community. Judy could just as easily, or even more easily, have brought in some dirty water to test or some preserved specimens to observe. But this would have denied the students with the opportunity to connect the classroom content to the local space in a meaningful way. My colleagues and I are currently working with Judy to document her approach to teaching science so that our pre-service teachers can learn from her, even now that she's retired. Taking a page from Judy's book, my colleagues and I are working with elementary teachers to connect classroom activities to local engineering opportunities. One of the standards that Amanda Rapstad's fourth grade students are supposed to explore is how humans can use their knowledge of science to help mitigate the effects of natural disasters, such as flooding. Rather than learn about flooding in general, the students explored local flooding concerns in Gallatin County, specifically focusing on Three Forks and the flooding caused by recent ice jams in the Gallatin River. After modeling the impacts of different mitigation strategies, students designed their own solutions to protect houses that could be at risk of damage due to ice jam-related flooding along the Gallatin River. These young engineers also stepped in to help the citizens of Denton, Montana by building box fan air filters to reduce wildfire smoke particles in the air. Afterwards, one young engineer said, "I feel like a real engineer. I feel good about myself." All of the students had inner scientists and engineers waiting to come out. They just needed some help connecting the local science and engineering to themselves. Hearing students say things like this and watching them engage excitedly in local science and engineering contexts gives me hope for the future. Hope that these budding scientists and engineers will grow up to make discoveries and solve problems that will benefit Montana and beyond. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Robert Carson, and my presentation is titled, How Art Teaches Us to See.
Sorry.
A little music helps, too. As a graduate student 30-some years ago, I hit a point where I was utterly saturated with print media, reading and writing. Black and white. My mind was thriving, but my soul was dying. On an impulse, I went out and bought a set of acrylic paints, some brushes, canvases, and I began to paint pictures. It was something I had always wanted to do, and in that instant, I just decided to do it. I'm not a trained artist, but I consoled myself with the pleasing notion that it does not matter whether you know what you're doing or not. It is the experience that counts. Such a postmodern revelation. Very liberating. This artistic digression became a pleasing counterpoint to the highly cerebral work of scholarship. It allowed me to escape into a different world. It still requires a kind of analysis, but of color, shape, form, and visual effects. For this, you use different parts of your brain. I completed my PhD in 1991 and was then hired by my beloved Montana State University. A lot happened in my first 10 years, but I eventually started painting again, with oils this time. And I discovered that oil paints are a beautiful and luxurious medium to work in. I've always loved art. Whenever I'm in a new city, I visit the art museums. The Art Institute of Chicago was a staple of my childhood. Largely due to their remarkable collection, I became fascinated by Impressionist art, which no doubt gets reflected in my approach to painting. The Impressionists were intellectual beneficiaries of phenomenology. In this view, the human mind does not receive images ready-made, but constructs the representative images of reality from the chaos of sensory input. Thus, perception is an active process, a creative endeavor. The Impressionists asked, what are the elements of vision? Their answer, patches of light and shadow, colors, borders, movement, forms. Instead of trying to paint a photorealistic image, they rendered these elements of vision onto canvas, from which the viewer engages and actively constructs the resulting imagery. So you loosen up your brush stroke, you allow your actions to be guided more by emotion and instinct and impulse. There is still an analytical aspect, but it is less cerebral and more holistically inclusive of our visceral, emotional, affective, and subliminal capacities. The year before I entered graduate school, I had spent 4 months traveling through Europe on a budget and on a bicycle from London to Istanbul, visiting museums and historical places. In Paris that summer, I had a profound aesthetic experience at the old Impressionist Museum. I was viewing paintings by Monet in which motion is suggested, flags or trees fluttering in the wind, water rippling on the surface of lakes or streams. By my letting go and relaxing into those images, they came alive for me with that suggested motion. I spent perhaps an hour just enthralled. Still in this strangely rarefied state, I went out onto the streets of Paris where the whole scene before me now looked like an Impressionist painting. It was surreal. For a while, those paintings, the world, and my mind became conjoined in this dynamic unity of art and beauty. And no, I wasn't smoking anything. My subsequent engagement with art and with the literature on the history, theory, and philosophy of art has caused me not only to better appreciate art, more surprisingly, it has permanently enhanced the way I see the world. And I have come to believe that perhaps that is the most important role that art plays. We learn to look upon a scene and ask, how would I paint that? How would I render that atmosphere, that sunlight, those shadows, the relationship between the details and the overall gestalt of that scene before me? And what is the feeling that I am getting from this moment? These paintings that I'm showing you, they are places where I have been. When I travel, I occasionally have these sublime aesthetic moments. And when I do, I try to take pictures and I try to memorize the whole aesthetic feel of it so I can try to recreate it later. The last few paintings were from a conference I attended at Lake Como, Italy, one of the most beautiful places on earth. This one is of the actual conference venue where we gave our sessions. And this little shack is called Villa Balbianello, located across Lake Como from Bellagio. This is my favorite painting. When I look at it, I can still feel exactly what it was like to be there. This is a market in Agadir in west central Turkey. That was the first time I tried to paint people. Anyway, I'm not trying to impress you with my art. I am an amateur, which I freely admit. But ironically, that makes my message maybe more accessible and relevant. As we interact with our own visual experience through the medium of art, that effort creates a feedback loop which enhances the ways in which we see the world. A similar insight applies to any immersive study of literature, of math, of science, of history, philosophy, theology, poetry. Our final painting is titled The Birth of Geometry. It reflects another interest of mine, how our study of mathematics has served to cultivate new ways of thinking and new ways of perceiving the world. The theory of liberal education holds that we empower and liberate the human mind when we pursue teaching and learning with these kinds of cultural purposes in mind. Thank you.
The son of the founder of that school is here with us today. Oddly enough, I didn't invite him, he just invited himself here because he is an MSU alumni who currently lives in Phoenix and happened to be traveled to Bozeman for today for his birthday. Mo Foles, would you please stand up for us to give you our best What a coincidence. Now I'm worried because I didn't know that our collaborator is going to be here. We are MSU Food Product Development Lab, which is built on the traditional territory of Crow, Nez Perce, Salish, Lakota, and Northern Cheyenne. The lab mission is developing products healthy for both humans and the earth. Today's story is about how we, coming from different places in the world, unlearn and relearn the true meaning of value-added agriculture. I came from Taiwan, which is an island nation 10 times smaller than Montana, 23 times larger the population than Montana. We used to be really proud of our agriculture because we grow some of the best teas, fruits, and rice varieties in the nation and around the world. However, that has been threatened by free trade agreements and competition from neighboring countries. So in 2011, I decided to leave my beloved home country and come to the USA to study food science and technology, because I believe that science and technology is the answer to solve the agricultural crisis if we can add value using technology for our agricultural produce. We can make something that sells better and save our producers. The first day when I arrived at the USA, after flying 30 hours across Pacific Ocean, I was so tired, I was nervous, I knew nobody here. I already missed my parents. At the airport, I saw this food, smells good, look good,
You know what it is? Fresh off the plant, decided to give it a try. Still remember the first time I had that first bite of this food, which later I knew it's called pretzel. It was extremely salty, unbearably salty. I stood at the airport, looking at people passing by me. I asked myself the first question I landed at USA. What's wrong with Americans? It actually surprised me more after several months of study into sodium reduction. I realized that the people from my home country, people from Asian countries, are actually eating a lot more sodium. This totally doesn't make sense. Everything I taste here is way more salty. So I started to reflect on what makes the difference between the total amount of sodium in food versus the sensation of saltiness. If you like orange chicken, you enjoy the sweet, sour, savory, umami, a little bit salty, crunchy, sticky, floury, and everything is great. But this complex sensory sensation of so many layers of experience that you didn't know it actually has a lot of hidden salt. So that drove me to think about the difference between culture preference of food, the culinary traditions. It matters. And that's not something necessarily technology can answer. So is technology the only tool that I need to have in order to make a good value-added product? In 2017, I landed my first job at Montana State University. My contract said that I have to add value into Montana produce to increase the profit. But later you'll hear from my student. They will share with you, the more we work with our producers, with our native communities, the more we question, what exactly is the value we're talking about? Is it money?
So when it comes to value added, I know from first level, my name is Genesis Chavez and I am from Nicaragua. I country located in the heart of Central America. The first time I met my advisor, Dr. Ku, she asked, what are the indigenous food of your culture? So I passed and I told her, let me talk to my grandma. My grandma makes the best tortillas. And for you to make a tortilla, you have to go through 6 steps and spend about 10 hours. This is how vendors make tortillas in a local market. They only earn less than 3 cents per tortilla. So for many years, I noticed that vendors experienced several challenges due to the lack of infrastructure for food processing, storage, and distribution, thus threatening consumers' food safety and the economic resilience of the local food market. While living in Montana, where I'm conducting my graduate research, I noticed a similar situation occurring at the Flathead Reservation. These communities experienced several unique barriers that inhibit sustainable development and food access. Therefore, our lab partner with the Native Fish Keeper Inc., a tribal nonprofit working to preserve native fish by harvesting invasive lake trout species and selling those fresh frozen fillets across Montana. Thus, we partner to combine food science and traditional knowledge to develop 2 smoked lake trout products to add value and further offset fisheries cost. These products are being developed not with profitability as its first priority, but rather with cultural, ethical, and environmental values defined by the community. You don't put a price tag on a bison because it is a human, a community member expressed during a focus group discussion. The global food system has failed to account for the true cost of industrialized food production. Therefore, it is critical that we not only support local resilient food systems, but we also support and empower indigenous communities who are integral to the health of our planet. worldwide, indigenous people represent 5% of the global population, and yet they store 80% of the remaining global biodiversity.
Of global remaining biodiversity, you might ask, so what? My name is Edwin, and I'm from Ghana in West Africa. The northern part of Ghana grows pulses such as Bambara beans. These beans provide great nutrition to our children, but now they are going extinct. 41% of children in West Africa are suffering from undernutrition because of this. In 2018, I joined MSU and started a partnership with Senegalese smallholder farmers. They told us, we used to harvest gum from the forest for our children, but the forest has become farmland. Now we ride horse car for 4 hours to get imported gum. This is why I came to the USA. I want to learn value-added processing to protect our crops and to improve nutrition. So with the Senegalese farmers, we developed a children's nutrition bar. The bar has baobab fruit, which is indigenous to West Africa. Baobab means tree of life, and baobab offers vitamin C, folate, and fiber, which is critical for children's growth. Baobab trees are wildly grown and cannot be domesticated. So to maintain the nutrition bar production, we protect baobab trees. The nutrition bar was named by the women farmers as Bombombui, which translates as Baobab Delight. Initially, when we asked the women farmers to name their nutrition bar, they said, women don't name things. Women in West Africa are the value-added force, but they don't have economic equity. I have passed this project on to our new lab members who are working to support the women farmers to begin an enterprise.
My name is Sage Stevens, and I am one of the undergraduate members on the previous project. And so what drew me into this project particularly is the emphasis on women's roles within both indigenous food systems as well as empowering women through their roles within that system. And so this was their previous bakery, essentially, in the village, and it was used by all the farmers, but it was also owned particularly by the male leaders within the community, and there was a severe disparity in the upkeep and access to it. And so now, in partnership with chemical engineering teams at MSU, we have designed this factory that is women as a women-oriented safe space for them, as well as serving as a community space as well. And within that as well, we're working to develop this business that they are owning and co-opting and promoting those sustainable food systems.
Back again. Now, I'm pursuing a PhD at MSU. My PhD focuses on how Montana can benefit from value-added agriculture. Montana leads America in pulse production and is involved in the fast-growing industry of local berry production. What happens to these crops? 85% of pulses are exported, and only 1% of farms in Montana add value to their crops. So what role can value-added processing play in sustainable agriculture? How can Montana farmers benefit from local pulses and local berries? Value-added processing creates profitable new products without requiring farmers to have large yields or to farm mainstream crops. The addition of other ingredients in product development also improves nutrition and creates a more diverse nutrient profile. In addition to dietary diversity, Value-added processing satisfies contemporary food preferences and dietary needs. With this in mind, the Food Product Development Lab is using extrusion to develop lentil texturized vegetable protein, which is used to make veggie burger patties. It's using extrusion to make lentil pasta and lentil puffs. Value-added processing also increases shelf stability, which means less food is wasted. Using a freeze dryer, the Food Product Development Lab is making a smoothie blend from local berries. Growing these local berries also encourages crop diversification. All these projects can be done at a local scale. We are inspired to continue to pursue value-added processing by David Owen, the CEO of Timeless Seeds. He was asked to get big or get out, but he stayed put. He stayed small and he planted lentils. Now we make lentil crackers for the Livingston Food Resource Center for their child nutrition program. Thank you.
From a bite of pretzel to a glance of the big sky of sub-Saharan Africa, from Taiwan to Nicaragua to Ghana and to the USA, Montana. We coming from different places in the world have come to learn the true meaning of value-added agriculture. It's not just about using technology to extract the resources from our surroundings. More, it's about how we learn from the culture of our producers and community members from indigenous societies, how they have been taking care of the land for us, and try to use our science and technology combined with traditional wisdom to convert what the land has raised and grow for us into food vehicles that deliver health and knowledge to our next generations for both human and environmental societies. We have the Bon Bon Gui Peanut Nutrition Bar made this afternoon. Please try some and tell us how they taste. We have sensory evaluation, do the survey, you get $5 gift card. Thank you very much. Je le devoir. Amen.
I had about this event, there was a really big spotlight on me, so I really appreciate the understated lady. My name is Anna Elliott, and I'm an associate professor in the graduate counseling program. Preparing for this talk was really challenging for me, because for the 10 years that I've been teaching in higher education, I've never written out what I was going to say ahead of time, and I've rarely presented in lecture form. When I started my doctoral work, I had to reckon with the fact that I had debilitating public speaking anxiety, something that you think I might have thought through before studying to become someone who is required to speak publicly. But nonetheless, there I was, trying to prepare for my first lecture on Jungian psychoanalysis, just like a real light topic, physically in pain with how much anxiety I was experiencing. And that discomfort lasted up until the moment I stood in front of the classroom and started to speak, at which point the anxiety began to fade. I remembered to breathe, and I focused on creating a connection between myself and the students. I moved through the fear by accessing meaning to the material and inviting them to do the same. And that has continued to be the case, where my heart is connected to the topic, to the students' learning, and I have the space to co-construct meaning with whoever the group is. I'm focused on what learning we can access together. It's funny looking back on that first class I taught, because one of the things I did to regulate my anxiety was to admit to the students that I was really scared of teaching. One of my close friends in the program who came from a theater background told me afterward, "Don't tell the audience you're scared, because you have a better poker face than I think you realize, and you can't actually tell you're afraid. So you're giving away that power unnecessarily. Act confident and you'll become confident." And she was right. Mainly because while I was saying it out loud to remove the pressure I felt to hide my fear, I was also essentially pleading with them to be nice to me. Because I was scared. And while that's human, it's not generally an inspiring form of leadership. So, I'm going to share with you that I feel scared right now. But me sharing that discomfort with you today is coming from a different place inside of me. Because right now, I'm making a conscious choice to be vulnerable. I'm not pleading with you to be nice to me. I'm inviting you to join me in open-heartedness. So, for anyone who's been in counseling before, and if you haven't, maybe you should try it. You know that inevitably, to understand why you're struggling in the present, you have to go back to where it began. And I don't have time in 10 minutes to get into my childhood, so we'll start when I was 25. After I graduated from college, I worked with teenagers for 4 years before I decided I was ready to take the next step forward to get my master's degree. I was out to dinner one night with two of my male friends who I had worked in the mental health field with, and one of my friends mentioned he was thinking about applying for counseling programs. My friend Tyler said to him, "Oh, you're too smart for counseling. That's such a waste." I interjected, "I'm applying to counseling programs right now." He looked at me and brushed me off with, "But you have such a big heart." It was an offhanded comment, but it was one that stayed with me, and that I would return to during moments of self-doubt or existential crises about what I was doing, about what I was worth. Because the implied message was that I was well-suited for mental health, not because of my intelligence or my potential skill or ability to help, but because I was a nice person. I also told this story to a student recently who was expressing doubt about her own intelligence, and her response to me, after expressing relief to hear that she wasn't the only one who doubted herself in this way, was, "You're not even that nice." So now I can look forward to future dark moments where I contemplate how I'm both mean and stupid. But this message of being nice but not smart continued to show up as I moved forward into higher education, where it felt like this question of intelligence, of academic fortitude, was set up in juxtaposition with kindness, with heart, with an emphasis on relationship. How these were quaint ideas or attributes, but not ultimately of value. When I find myself in larger academic circles outside of counseling, I catch myself offering the self-deprecating identifier, "Oh me, I'm just a doctor of feelings." When I started my doctoral training, I was ambivalent about whether I belonged and also if I wanted to be there. I felt deeply passionate about counseling, and I immediately fell in love with getting to facilitate the learning process of counselors in training, a love that I still very much have today. But I worried about the contrast between the values being emphasized in the training: authenticity, vulnerability, unconditional positive regard, and connection with ego, competitiveness, and the misuse of power I observed in the larger academic arena. I wondered if I would be able to hold on to my sense of integrity, or if I would succumb to the pressures of this environment. I decided to write my dissertation on this process, finding an authentic and integrated professional identity within academia. Like all good dissertations, it ended up with a very tedious title: The Process of Personal and Professional Identity Integration of Doctoral Students in Counselor Education. But the secret title was How to Not Become an Asshole in Academia. And my results illustrated a process of key themes that influence students' experiences of moving through the trials and tribulations of a doctoral program, like learning from relationship, self-reflection, perseverance. but the key aspect of the process that determined the depth of students' development was the way that they responded to critical incidences, to encounter themselves and learn from the experience, or to avoid, blame, project. Outwardly, everyone ended up with the same degree, but internally, the qualitative interviews demonstrated a distinction based on how they handled those moments. So I carried that perspective with me when I moved to Bozeman in 2015, that my main task was to remain connected to both the reason I started and to be accountable to myself in those challenging moments, those opportunities to grow. To be very clear, this is not to say my ego does not show up in this job. I can be competitive, I compare myself to my colleagues, I take it personally when I don't get acknowledged for something that I worked hard on, or when a student takes a kidney punch in a course evaluation. But as I've grown as a professor, I have also learned to trust myself more, so that I can both notice when I'm acting from a place of defense and access grace in acknowledging that I am both imperfect and worthy. So there's always been this dissonance between the thing that drew me to this job and the pressure from the larger academic system to teach, to inspire, to create, but also to perform and prove. This pull has become more pronounced since COVID began. The world shut down, and the directive we received was just to keep going. And to be very clear, I felt very supported by my department and my college, but I think it's a pressure that all of us were under. And while I experience privilege in my job security, it's been exhausting. We're burning out, we're overscheduled. I don't have the ability to sustain myself in a job where there is so much pressure to produce while simultaneously trying to stay engaged in work that I still love. I told my husband recently that I would have a mental breakdown if I could just find a spot in my calendar to squeeze it in. Because I'm over capacity. And since I decided that this is what I wanted to talk about tonight, this funny thing has happened. As I drive to work in the morning as the sun is coming up over the mountains, or as my thoughts begin to settle at night, I find myself mulling over what really matters to me these days, and just weeping. I cried on the way here. With sadness and exhaustion, yes, but also with love, and with gratitude, and compassion. Instead of breaking down, I'm actually cracking open in the best way. And these days, it can be overwhelming. It can be uncomfortable, even terrifying, to be in contact with what I see and how I feel in response to what I see. But I also observe that it gets worse when I harden, compete, compare, deflect, defend, attack, numb. I get further away from myself and everyone else. My approach to being a doctor of feelings demands that I stay open. Because to be a good teacher, a good counselor, a good person, I need to be in contact with myself so that I can reach others. And I don't say any of this to separate myself from other faculty. I'm actually quite suspicious that we all feel this way. That it may benefit us all to consider the role of open-heartedness in our work and to also set limits around how much we need to prove. So that we can sustain, so that we can serve our students and our community. We have to take care of ourselves. It's so simple, but we're not doing it. So what if we breathe right now? And soften and let in. What if we all choose meaning over measure? Thanks.
Down.
Let's cross the hill.
Oh my God.
And the town lit up.
Oh,
the
evening, EHHD family. It's great to be here tonight. My name is Joe Hicks, assistant teaching professor in the Department of Education. I want to thank you all for being here, and also all my fellow presenters for all the time you invested in preparing and sharing your stories tonight. Truly, it's been an enjoyable process to go through with you. And so tonight, I am here to present Vocation of M, Becoming a Bobcat Educator. For those of you who aren't familiar with the term VIM, it's defined as energy or enthusiasm, and it's illustrated perfectly here during one of those magical learning moments by these students and one of our very own pre-service teachers in a local after-school program. Teaching for me has always been a vocation of VIM. And put in a different context, VIM cannot be better exemplified than in this image of Champ, our MSU cheer squad, and our most recent graduating student teacher cohort. As a two-time graduate, faculty member, and EHHD assistant dean, I know firsthand there is something special about being a Bobcat educator. Unbeknownst to me at the time, my path to education began early on, growing up in Grand Teton National Park in company housing in a two-bedroom log cabin. Here you can see myself, brother, sister, and dog on our roof, which doubled as our first ski hill. With only one neighbor for miles around, you could say this was my first taste of experiential education at its very best. On the more formal side of education, and like you, I had many influential educators who made a real difference in my life. From my first grade teacher, Miss Judy Bailey, who took a struggling reader and put me on a path to success in literacy, to my senior government and student council advisor, Mr. Jeff Parrott, who went out of his way to support me both inside and outside the classroom. This brings me to my senior year photo. Sweet haircut, right? Portraying a kid who didn't even think of college until the end of their junior year. As a first-generation college student, I ultimately decided on attending MSU due to their personalized approach. Yet I distinctly remember sitting in the Roski Hall parking lot after the first day of summer orientation, filled with self-doubt, and was ready to drive home. I'm so glad I didn't. As this picture captures well, my experiences on the 10th floor of South Hedges Hall, go south, would quickly become a true home away from home. Starting with residence life staff, they believed in me when I didn't even believe in myself. This led me on a student leadership track, where, like I say, I double majored, first as secondary social studies, and second as a campus involvement major. And yes, I even became homecoming king, something my students always enjoy coming across when they see the image in the sub. Allow me to be clear, this has very little to do with me or what I accomplished, but more of the tremendous support I felt from the faculty, staff, and my peers. If you could imagine, it was difficult for me to leave MSU and Bozeman after graduation, but I knew I'd be back someday. Being from a small town, Wyoming, I had always had a lifelong dream of living and working in the nation's capital. Little did I know that after a stopover in Laramie, Wyoming afterwards for graduate school, I would finally begin my teaching career, eventually bringing student groups of my own to DC to experience what I had lived firsthand only a few short years before and help bring their US history curriculum to life. My time as a middle school social studies teacher in Greeley, Colorado, equipped me with just seemingly ready to handle anything, but most importantly, taught me that the key to unlocking learning potential started with building quality relationships with my students. A lesson I've held close at mind and heart to this very day. Further, I learned so much from my fellow teaching colleagues. Before leaving, I was really hitting my stride and becoming very comfortable in my role as a K-12 teacher. But in the back of my mind, I always wanted to return to Bozeman and MSU. And when the opportunity presented itself, I thought of no better fitting way than to return as a faculty member at the very same college and department that helped set me on this path. Transformative. Of the many great suggestions our department head at the time and current faculty member, Dr. Jane Downey, offered when I first started was to make sure I was creating a transformative experience in my classes and in working with my students. Little did I know, I was going to be even more transformed through my students and the school field experiences I would help facilitate. When asked to speak about what excites me in preparation for this presentation, three areas immediately came to mind. Rural field experiences, non-resident undergraduates, and our EDU 101 freshman seminar. Combined, these teaching and learning opportunities have infused the vim that I spoke about in my opening and have helped to really help me grow as a professional. As a college and department, we have a long-standing commitment to our land-grant roots and in serving our rural schools and communities. With the majority of my time teaching at MSU centered on clinical practice, courses within school placement, I'm proud that our pre-service teachers have opportunities to gain invaluable experience working with students every year at the program. As part of our integrating technology course, Beth Kennedy and I led a group of Tech Club pre-service teachers up to Central Montana for a 3-day immersive experience where they facilitated STEAM-based lessons to K-5 learners in Roy, Grass Range, and Lewistown, and later would present on their experiences during the International Symposium on Rural Education Conference hosted by our very own research and rural department. Speaking of transformative, this experience completely flipped the script for these aspiring educators, as their previous deficit mindset of rural education quickly changed to strengths-based outlook. Haley came to realize the potential for differentiation in smaller schools, and instead of teaching in a AA school district like she originally planned, she ended up accepting a rural position in Rosebud Public Schools. For Alex, pictured in the middle, while her family had multi-generational roots in rural Montana, she still wasn't sure if the setting was for her. Following her experience in Rural Tech Club, Alex completed a rural practicum in North Star School District in Guilford, and then accepted a position in Libby Middle High School as an English teacher. In spring of 2017, Dr. Tina Verslin envisioned and led a rural practicum experience that would bring a number of us together across our education and English departments on campus. Collectively, we created our first ever rural practicum. This experience started with gatherings in spring semester, an accelerated course in early May, and culminated in a week-long immersive experience in Sidney, Montana, and the surrounding communities. Talk about VIM. This group of 13 pre-service teachers were extraordinary ambassadors of our program, hailing from hometowns as far away as Seattle, Cleveland, and San Francisco. Their contributions and reflections, combined with the extraordinary efforts of our department team and K-12 school partners, would set the stage for several subsequent iterations of rural practicum, with our next one taking place in Glendive next month. To witness and be a part of this team was one of the most exciting aspects of being a Bobcat educator, as I was able to team in a side-by-side model with my pre-service teachers and colleagues, as we were immersed in amazing rural communities that serve as the heart and soul of Montana. Such early field experiences clearly make an impact, and the interest in rural education has only grown, and is so talked about amongst our students that we have to do very little recruiting anymore to get them to sign up. Pictured here is a graduating student teacher cohort in the Norm Asbjornsen Hall Grand Staircase. I'm excited to think of how many of our graduates may choose to begin their teaching careers in rural communities across the great state of Montana. My second area of excitement involves exploring the lived experience, persistence, and sense of belonging of non-resident undergraduates at MSU through my own dissertation educational journey. As a previous non-resident undergraduate at MSU myself, having the opportunity to get to know 9 students and their stories was life-changing. The support I received throughout my coursework and all my way to my defense by my chair, Dr. Tricia Seifert, and the committee was nothing short of remarkable and speaks volumes about the high caliber of faculty that make up our department graduate programs as well. While I would have never imagined defending my dissertation virtually through WebEx, I can say that this team somehow provided a perfect balance of challenge and support. Of the many silver linings I've pulled from this pandemic time, it's finding ways to appreciate those things we may have taken for granted before, such as graduation, a time-held tradition on our campus and campuses around the world. To have the opportunity to walk across the stage with my family, mentors, colleagues, and students in the stadium to share this moment was truly a stand-up for this Bobcat educator. And finally, in previewing my work with EDU 101 Freshman Seminar, my third area of excitement, I want to share a side-by-side photo of my daughter, Hannah, during her first and last day of kindergarten just this last year, as it closely parallels the amount of time and growth and confidence building that takes place for a freshman. As a freshman seminar, this was amplified by the great variation of educational experiences this last fall's cohort brought to the class. In surveying our EDU 101 students, I found that only 40% had a full in-person high school senior year, whereas 25% were completely online, not to mention those that had taken a gap year or who had a difficult transition and had come back after a year removed. As you can appreciate, we took advantage of every opportunity to get outside of class, outside and have central discussions, with one being on what it means to be a learner. This pushes each and every one of us, myself included, to reflect on how we learn best and how to continually improve in the process. Undoubtedly, the questions presented in this seminar puts each individual in our education profession in places of vulnerability. However, it is these potential places of weakness that a true strength emerges in our collective community. After all, to freely share our experiences, thoughts, and dreams serves an investment not only in ourselves, but in our future students. As you can see, education serves as a central part of my identity and family. My wife, Sarah, is a tremendously gifted first grade teacher of 15 years. And while Hannah and James are on the very front end of their own educational journeys, they have both logged enough hours hanging out with Daddy in Reed Hall and the Duck Pond to at least have the equivalent of a few semesters under their belts. In closing, I'd like to share a quote from Matthew Sanders, author of the Becoming a Learner text in EDU 101. The hardest thing for you to know is the thing you think you already know. Accordingly, I continue to seek and continue to learn and grow, and to be cognizant of the fact that it's not only what you do, but how you do it. With this, I am so excited about the next years ahead, and I really want to express my great gratitude for all the opportunities that were presented to me as a student, as a faculty member, and an assistant dean. Thank you so much for your time tonight.
Don't go that far, Joe. Don't go too far, Joe. We have a couple birthdays in the house. One of them we've already announced. Wanyuan Kuo announced one. We have another one tomorrow, and that's Joe. So wouldn't it be nice if we just sang a little happy birthday right now? I'll step back from the mic, and we can sing together. Ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joe. Happy birthday to you.
To have a short panel, maybe just a one or two questions for each panelist. You may have written one down at your table, or you may feel inspired just to come on up and say your question into the microphone. So why don't you just give us 5 minutes, and maybe you need to go grab another snack or something, or some water or a drink. And we're gonna put some chairs up here so it's nice and cozy for our panel, and we'll figure out how to, you know, move this microphone around. And we'll meet you back here in 5 minutes. Okay, go. So the first question is for Rebecca, Becky. Becky, are you currently partnering with any particular engineering firm? And how might you work with a community engineer in your work?
So I'm not partnering with a particular firm. I have some excellent colleagues in the Department of Engineering, but also I found that usually in a classroom there are parents who are engineers, or they have neighbors who are engineers, and it's pretty easy to find somebody who is wanting to come in and talk. So that's kind of, what was the rest of the question? Sorry.
How might you work with?
Oh, how might I work with them? I think there is a balance between having them come in, and I think the kids love to hear them talk. They love to know what's going on, but also helping the engineers know how to present these really technical terms to third graders sometimes can be a little crazy. So it always involves bringing in cool hands-on gadgets and letting the kids get all excited about that. But as far as partnering and working with engineers, it's really just about finding out what they do and how they are involved in benefiting the community, and then helping them find a way to share that message with kids so that kids can see that they're not just these like people with hard hats. They're actually out there solving problems, and these are the things that you look around and see.
Thank you. The second question is for Anna. It's a two-parted question. One, part one, how did you get so flippin' incredible? part two is you mentioned gratitude, and so I'm just wondering if you could talk about how you use gratitude to help you deal with that overwhelmed feeling.
Real light question. How do I use gratitude to deal with overwhelm? Just more vulnerability, I guess. I think that everything that's happened in the past 2 years with COVID has brought us into deeper awareness of how little control we have over a lot of things in the world, even in our smaller communities. And so I feel like when that first hit, I spent a lot of time just kind of wrestling and reckoning with that sense of helplessness, that sense of powerlessness. And I was driving to work one day, and it was icy out, and I was coming up to an intersection and didn't give myself enough time to stop and started to slide a little bit and come into an intersection, and everything was fine, but it was one of those, you know, kind of scary moments as I had been sort of sitting there, like, brooding about the state of things. And I just realized that, like, I could have died in that moment, and I would have spent those last moments feeling sad and depressed about things that were outside of my control. And so sticking to what I know and what I have control over, which is my family, my relationships, my jobs, the impact that I can have on a community. I can't change everything out there, but I can change my corner. I can change things close to home, and that helps me access gratitude.
So this is a question for the pretzel hater.
Yes, I still hate it.
So what you had, I know you do, in part of this is connecting with these communities and trying to understand what it is they want in addition to how they can add value. And I'm wondering if you can just talk a little bit more about the community side of the projects that you work on in either Senegal or over at CSKT.
Would you like to talk about the CSKT? It's convenient, students are here.
So since last year, we started having conversations with our collaborators, or the CSKT, and we have realized how little we know about their culture and how much do they have to offer. And it's been incredible to learn how much do they appreciate things that we might seem as like insignificant, and how like they will have food as a form of like gathering, but food meaning like there's a boundary like in the family, and we come together and we like have food to celebrate our identity and who we are. And by working with them, we have come to learn to like appreciate and know appropriate what they have, and that's been like a huge learning lesson for me, because at food product developers, we tend to find ingredients of like we brainstorm, we ideate, and we want to come up and develop these fabulous product that it's going to be amazing in the market. And the reality is that like over the 75% of like entrepreneurs fail, and it is because you really gotta have a competitive advantage over the rest of the food companies, the food industry. But these people is not looking for a competitive advantage. They are not looking to position their like food in like the top companies. They are looking for ways to preserve their food heritage, to add value, and furthermore to take care of the food ecology, and really look forward to develop sustainable food systems.
Well, short answer is a lot of meetings. And I think the most challenging part for us Well, there's a few challenges. There's a big time difference, and then all of the official papers in Senegal are in French, so we have to do this translation. I'd say the biggest point, I mean, as we talked about with Mo, and just we also have other community members in Senegal, and like having those people on the ground. And fortunately, Mo's just been a good connection point of us just like getting a good just like network set up within Senegal, as well as just figuring out, okay, like what is a good way to go into this and into this approach. And then with the women farmers, the other like really challenging part is you can't just like send an email. It's really rural. And so we have Aliou, who is in Dakar, and he's able to go to the community. And so we do a lot of the work through and a lot of the evaluation and just the research and just seeing how we want to approach that development through surveys. And so a lot of breaking it down to like the minute questions we want to get done and really just like breaking it up and being patient with that. So I think, yeah, just being really strategic about the time you're spending on those things. Because again, yeah, time difference as well. Like we can't just be having meetings every other day at any time, because anytime we want to be having a meeting is usually middle of the night in Senegal. So we have to be really, yeah, intentional with the time that we're spending with those community members to ensure that we're maximizing those communication points.
Do I still have time? I want to use two quotes that we learned from our two communities to summarize. So CSKD Confederated Salish and Kootenai Tribes, when I proposed to them, let's do value added together, let's add value to our local economy, they don't want value added. That's how it got us to think about what is value added to them. For Senegal communities, they want us to be there, they want us to visit them, they want value added. So it's kind of the opposite scenario, but it all boils down to they want something for their community. So one quote from CSKT, they said, berries and bisons are my families. It's really hard to commercialize them if you consider they are my families. So that's why they don't want value added. And they want us, the Senegal community want us to visit them. The chief of one of the community, he told us, Americans just come to do research with us, but they just took our foods away. When are you coming back? We wanted you to come here, stay with us, do value added processing here with us.
Not bad for a pretzel hater, but Wan Yuan does amazing work with her students in her lab, so it's not surprising she has some amazing ones here. Are there other questions?
This is for Robert. It was a two-part question. One is, are any of your paintings for sale? And the second part is, how do you see using your art in the future?
No. And I don't know. She's so persuasive, you know. It's a high-powered dean here. I can't. I don't know if I'll ever try to sell them or not. You know, that was never the point of it. As I described it in the little presentation, it has always been sort of one of these many things that I would have aspired to. Racing Formula One cars would be another, but I haven't gotten there yet. But this one was accessible, and it was very much complementary to the major thing I was doing with sort of my whole being, and that was immersing myself in professional literature. I took my graduate studies very seriously. I worked hard at it, and I loved it. It was really great. But you know, you need something to balance it. And this just turned out to be the thing that that worked really well for me. And so, you know, to try to replicate or to paint a scene that's either in front of you or on a photograph or something puts you into a kind of interactive communion between your own mind and whatever you're putting on the canvas and whatever the image is that you're sort of working off of. And so it's a real pleasant and kind of zen thing to do, particularly if you're not trying to impress anybody with it, you're not trying to make a living off of it. So, I mean, that's why I said, hence my first answer, simply because as I get back into it, yes, and I am going to be retiring after this semester, and it is one of the things I want to do, but I don't want all of you calling me up and asking to buy a painting. No, I don't know. So, did I say enough?
Thank you. And I have a question for Joe as well, and that is, Joe, what advice do you have for an instructor who's feeling low on vim right now, and why is that important in the classroom? Like, how do you generate that for your students, and why do you think that's important?
I would say, I mean, it sounds really simple, but just finding every possible opportunity to cultivate that relationship with your students. I think, you know, we have our content to deliver, you know, all the strategies, methods, et cetera, but I think if you don't, you know, fully know your audience and where they're coming from, and just appreciate just all the different experiences and what they bring, and find opportunities to bring that into the classroom. And so I've just been just amazed at the quality of students we have, the different things that they've overcome, that resilience that I think inspires me to be able to kind of push through those more difficult times, and to just kind of really kind of celebrate the moment in their lives, both as just a human being, let alone as a pre-service teacher.
Thank you. So I just, maybe to conclude, I just want to say that I feel inspired and humbled and enlightened and comforted and enthused by this group, and I hope that you did too. And I just want to say thank you to each of you for spending the evening with us. Are there any other concluding feelings or remarks that need to be made, Becky or Mary?
I'm gonna put up the peanut nutrition bar survey after the panel's done, so people can scan the QR code.
So you will see a QR code, and that is how you can complete the survey about the peanut nutrition bar, and we would appreciate it very much, wouldn't we? Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here. Have a wonderful day.